knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
With oxidative addition and reductive elimination covered, let's learn about a totally different kind of organometallic reaction called the migratory insertion. This occurs when two ligands are cis to one another, as X and Y are right here, and one of them inserts itself into the other metal ligand bond. So here, X has left its coordination site and inserted itself into the MY bond. This leaves a vacant site for another ligand to coordinate. Some key points to understand about this are as follows. First, insertion is usually reversible. The ligand may insert and then subsequently return to its original position. Only once a strong ligand binds to the vacant site does the insertion become irreversible, as the inserted ligand has nowhere to return to. Second, there is no change in the oxidation state of the metal through this overall process. Third, it should be emphasized that X and Y must be cis to one another. This process is not possible for trans ligands. And lastly, the ligands that are able to do this must have pi bonds present, so the carbonyl is the ligand most commonly involved in migratory insertion. Let's look at some simple examples. Here is an iron complex with four carbonyl ligands and one alkyl ligand. Any of these three carbonyl ligands in the equatorial plane would be capable of inserting into this metal-carbon bond. So let's move this one here, which gives us this new carbonyl-containing ligand. While it is actually the case mechanistically that the MC bond is migrating and attacking the carbonyl in most cases, it is often okay to simplify things conceptually by imagining the carbonyl ligand shifting over. Now let's say that trimethylphosphine coordinates to the vacant site. The insertion is now irreversible. Notice that the charge on the complex and the oxidation state of the metal do not change over either step in this pathway. Let's also learn a slightly different type of migration where a ligand coordinates to another ligand rather than inserting into the metal-ligand bond. Here is a tungsten complex with two CP ligands, a phenyl, and a carbene. The phenyl can migrate to the other side of this carbon atom, such that we end up with a sigma bond from the metal to the CH2, and then a sigma bond to the phenyl, so this is now essentially a benzyl ligand. Then this nitrile could coordinate, making the migration irreversible. Here is a similar example, which is called a hydrometalation. We see a niobium complex with two CP star ligands, a hydride, and an alkene. This hydride can migrate over to this carbon, and in doing so, the alkene will shift from this pi interaction to this sigma interaction, and is thus now a simple alkyl ligand. Coordination of another ligand could then occur in the vacant position. We should note that before further coordination occurs, this process could also go in reverse, which would qualify as beta elimination, to yield the original complex. The metal-carbon bond becomes the pi bond, which kicks a hydride over to an empty orbital on the metal, and we are back where we started. Entire alkene ligands can also perform migratory insertion with alkyl ligands, and we can call this carbometalation. Here is a zirconium complex with two CP ligands, a methyl and ethene. Ethene can insert into the MC bond, losing its pi bond in the process, resulting in a propyl ligand instead of a methyl. With a coordination site now free, another ethene ligand could coordinate and insert again, extending the carbon chain further. This could happen many times, constituting a polymerization reaction, and indeed, this is an important type of catalysis we will examine more closely later in the series. Now let's look at some complexes and discuss how they react. Here is an iron complex with a CP ligand, two carbonyls, and a methanide. Triphenylphosphine is available to react, but is there room? The ligand charges total to 2-, so iron must be 2+. And from a ground state of 4s2 3d6, that leaves us with the 6 d electrons. Plus the 6 from the cyclic ligand and 2 from each of the others, that's 18 electrons. This complex is stable and unlikely to react with the phosphine. But we do have two carbonyl ligands, which we know can undergo migratory insertion, and we do have an iron-carbon bond that can accommodate insertion, so let's push one of these carbonyls over there, which is another way of saying that the MC bond is being pushed onto the carbonyl ligand. Now we have a coordination site available, and the phosphine can coordinate to give us this. Here is another situation. We have a square planar platinum complex with a bidentate diphosphine and two alkoxides. Each alkoxide is 1-, so that's 2- from the ligands, so platinum must be 2+, and from 10 valence electrons we are down to 8. Plus 4 from the diphosphine and 4 from the two alkoxides, we get 16, and as we recall, square planar platinum complexes are quite stable with an electron count of 16. So when exposed to an excess of carbon monoxide, chemistry is possible, but a pathway that retains the 16 electron count is preferred. So one can coordinate, but immediately undergo migratory insertion into the metal oxygen bond to retain the electron count. Then another can coordinate and undergo migratory insertion into the other metal oxygen bond. With both ligands having accommodated a carbonyl, more insertion is unlikely. It is technically possible for double carbonylation to take place, where a carbonyl inserts next to an existing one, but this is more difficult to do and would not apply in this situation. With a few types of organometallic reactions understood, let's quickly look at a simple mechanism and make sure we can explain what's happening. We begin with this platinum complex. What's happening in this first step? It looks like one chlorine ligand has been lost, and the resulting complex has a formal positive charge, so this would be ligand dissociation. Next, this ethyl substituent has become an ethene substituent, coordinating from the pi bond, and we have a new hydride in this axial position. This looks like the opposite of a migratory insertion, so this was a beta hydride elimination. Then it looks like the ethene ligand left altogether, so that's another ligand dissociation. Next, we have lost this other ethyl ligand and a hydride, and they were cis to one another, so this must have been a concerted reductive elimination, resulting in the loss of ethane. And finally, it looks like another chlorine has claimed that empty coordination site, so this is ligand association, and we are left with this other platinum complex as the product. Later in the series, when we begin to learn about some industrially relevant organometallic reactions, which we can also refer to as catalytic cycles, we will see many mechanistic steps like these, but there are a few more left to learn, so let's check out some other types of reactions.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.